So we're going to spend 2 hours on that. And but before to start, I want to spend 5 minutes to recognize some exceptional people. We turned 2016, and four people did a terrific job last year. And I'm going to ask to Jim first to announce one of these four.
Good morning.
Morning.
That was the third time, so it's getting better. We got to warm you up for John. So, as Patrick said, we wanted to recognize four individuals from the sales organization for exceptional performance. And Jeremy, if you could stand up. We want to recognize Jeremy Robinson. And Jeremy exceeded his sales targets for 2016. So that was supported by the commercial recovery and the military recovery market. Miller was a good customer for us in 2016. And so that was a big help. But Jeremy worked hard to make sure that happened and occurred. And congratulations, Jeremy. Nice job.
We are going to continue with number two, and I'm going to call Brady. Come here. So as you know, one objective is to deliver, and Jeremy did a terrific job from the sales target point of view, and Brady did also a terrific job to create and build a very large pipeline of opportunities last year. So for that, thank you very much. Who is Ashley? You have Jesse. All right, we have also a specific prize. Here we go, we have Ashley. Ashley, you're on time. we have a specific prize, and one of the reason I joined this company is because of the Dover values. Terrific Dover values. And last year, we have one person in our company who did a terrific job to embrace the Dover values. And today, unfortunately, this person is not here because she is in Canada. So I'm going to give the prize to Ashley because he's a member of your team. But the name of this person is Debbie. So again, Debbie did a terrific job to embrace the Dover values. So on the other phone, Debbie, congratulations. We have a last one.
So I'm really excited to be able to present to Lori Marshall. But I don't see Lori. Has anybody seen Lori this morning?
Her husband's sick.
Oh, okay. All right. Thanks, Brady. Well, we'll keep Lori and her family in our thoughts and prayers then. But as many of you know, Lori always goes above and beyond. So our customers have learned that they can count on Lori to be there, not only to be there during the day, but I know many times they have reached out to her in the evenings, and she is always there. So we are very, very proud to have this award for Lori, and we will make sure that she gets it. So in her absence, let's give her a big round of applause. And for those of you who can't see these, they're very beautiful. It says an appreciation of your outstanding achievement and performance during 2016. So, again, congratulations to everyone. And thank you to everyone for all that you all do for TWG. Thanks.
All right, now I'm going to ask to our guest, John, if you can join me. So as you know, the main driver of this company is customer. And we are becoming, and we are going to accelerate that more and more, a customer-centric company. And I'm very excited today to have John. So John, thank you for being here, and I'll let you present your company and what you're doing.
No problem.
Thank you very much. For you all that might not know Miller Industries, let me give you a little bit of background on it. The towing and recovery business, we just celebrated 100 years anniversary. What Detroit is to the auto industry, Chattanooga is to the record, because that's where it started. Miller, Bill came and acquired in 1990 about five different companies, all struggling to be a place. Mr. Sparks worked for three of those companies and grew up himself in the towing and recovery business with Holmes and Challenger and Vulcan. And we've taken these various companies over that period of time, and we've put them all in one envelope under the Miller name. And each one of them, like in your winch groups, has their reason in their following. And that's why it's hard when you do these acquisitions that you just don't throw something out the wall, because you have a customer out there that's been buying it that believes in that product. In the large record line, we have the Vulcan product, which came out of Canada, went to Olive Branch, which is outside of Memphis, and then is now being built in Chattanooga. It's kind of like Mack Truck. You know, those guys that want that brand, and they have a liking that brand and the way that it works. And it looks similar to what a Century Record does, but it's not. You know, and in your group and what you've done with the GWG Winch Group, it's very much the same, whether it's from years apart being on the plant floor or the engineering, the marketing people, they have to look at that identity and keep that identity. So, and the towing side of the things, the next thing that we do is we don't deal with the United States government, we don't deal with it, though we do, but our 95% of our customers are family. They are successful entrepreneurs. When we went to the Florida trade show, I can remember Coronado Springs, which was about 10 years ago. I think we have a president, in case that you all didn't know, his name's Donald Trump. And if you go to CNN News or Fox, it just should be called Trump News, because that's all you get 24 hours a day. But Donald Trump was basically had busted out of penny stocks. You know, Atlantic City was falling apart. A lot of his investments that weren't really his investments, but other people's investments were failing. And in that point, it was a tough period of time during that era that we were in at this trade show some 10 years ago, very tough time economically for us to be challenged in here. And I looked at my customer base, and as we were talking and presenting the product in the booth, you know, I said, you guys are more successful because you're here paying the bills. And when you look at that as a family, that what we do in the towing business, it doesn't make a difference if it's a 2 or 3 unit operation or a 30 or 40 or even larger. We have up to 100 power units within some of our customers. That's rare. But it's family owned. It's not out there. It's not traded. You know, this guy's paying the insurance bills, you know, employees and all of the things that go with it. So we're responsible. We're held accountable. A tower is a 24/7, 365-day business. They don't go home at 8. I mean, it's come to work at 8 and go home at 5. They don't do that. You know, telephone rings and they go. One of the hardest things to do is retain an employee, but one of the easiest things to do also is to keep an employee, because the towing and recovery business is worse than cigarettes or some of the best drugs out there. It's addictive. Very addictive. And when it gets into their blood, you know, for that phone to ring at 2:30 in the morning and the guy to climb out of bed or a lady and, you know, go make that call, it's all about. They don't even hesitate. The thrill is, yes, the accident, the big accident, or that point of the challenge of doing the recovery that somebody else couldn't do. You have law enforcement breathing down these guys' back sometimes on the interstate. Other times they're out in a mine, you know, or what have you, and you've got a track hoe that's buried up to the engine in mud and muck, so they have times to work on it.
But it is that point because it's difficult. There isn't such a thing as a 40-hour, 45-hour week. It could be a 60-hour week. It could be more. You know, and the hardest thing is they got family, kids, ball games, birthdays. If you were to talk to towers, they can only tell you the amount of times that, you know, they've had to leave something because that phone rings and they're out there. And a lot of what you're seeing today in some of the Katrina situations and the Sandy operations is that these towers are going out there and they're getting ahead of the game. You know, Peter lived in New Jersey at that time. I was on the phone to Peter prior to the event happening with Sandy because they all knew it was coming. And so all of a sudden, these towers start forming a league of, amongst the various states, and they're going to Sunbelt and the various other companies to get generators loaded on their low boys, and they head to a proximity of where the storm's going. This was never done before. You didn't have a trucking company isn't going to go into the face of danger. It's not going to happen. And a tower, when the phone rings, they answer it and the call gets dispatched. So the insurance companies are noticing this, and now there's this army, so to speak, that when there is a natural weather event that's going to partake, they actually pre-event. Because can you imagine, you know, Sam's Club, Walmart, Publix, I don't know what some of the big supermarkets are around here, and you get into those areas of distribution and they lose power for 3 or 4 days, what the cost of that is, everything that's sitting there, especially if it has to be refrigerated. So, you know, these towers are actually going out there and bringing those generators in there, that stuff that people can, you know, get the generators running and keep the food and supply that territory, you know, while you get back up out of crisis. So the towing business is a 24/7 business, it's a family-based business, and it comes with a lot of responsibilities because this goes a long way. And you know, your client at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning will call myself or one of our team. We have a group of field reps, we have 100 distributors in North America, we sell worldwide. There isn't a military deal that's being let right now that Miller Industries isn't a part of it, and a lot of those winches that go on those units are the DP winch, you know. And that point is we do a tremendous amount of training that's out there in order to educate our clients and how to use those winches and how to use those recovery vehicles, because education brings life to something. You just can't turn something loose to somebody and expect them to be able to handle it. So we work out of Chattanooga, Tennessee. We have an operation up by Bristol where we build also 6, 7, and 8 car transporters. A lot of our towers do auto auctions, you know, where they'll go and sell a bunch of cars and then they'll load up 6, 7 cars and they'll take them from Florida to Michigan or whatever. So when we build the simple car carriers also out of the Bristol operation and our 19 and our 21 foot what we call champion line, which is an economy line, a low entry line, a throwaway carrier, so to speak, after 3 years. We just spent a lot of money in Western Pennsylvania where we have the Chevron product and the Century carrier built, and this really gets into the specifics. And car carriers are very, very much a part of what we do. You know, we are the largest buyer in the world every year of power units, no matter if it's Penske, U-Haul. We sell more cabs and chassis, about 5,000 every year, and that puts us number one for over 15, 20 years. So we're a big hitter when it comes to that. When we have issues with Cummins or Goodyear tires or whatever, we have the ability to go to work for our client and as a group because of that volume buying and get that support that you wouldn't be able to do if your problem with a Ford truck or a GM or a Dodge, and say that, you know, you would be coming out of your pocket as far as Miller supporting those people to say, we know there's a recognized issue and you need to step up to the plate. So it gives us a very big bat to swing at. And they partner up. We just had Peterbilt Truck Company in at the Monday night before I left to come out here yesterday. Crosby, here in your town. Crosby's a huge partner. And this is the key thing for us and the key thing for me. We can go offshore and buy offshore product that is not worth a damn for 60 cents on a dollar. It looks the same, it appears to be able to do the same, but the ductility in the Crosby product far exceeds what comes from the offshore product line. And in this industry that we're in, and the 4-to-1 safety factor, you have to meet that safety factor. You know, and I've been in a test facility and I've seen screw pin shackles and chains and hooks pulled, and with offshore product, they'll get to their, they'll get to that point of what they're rated at, and then they fail immediately. Fail immediately. You go to the Crosby product, it will meet and exceed their expectations, and once it gets past that expectation, you still have a percentage of ability for that, you know, that hook or that shackle to maintain its face and structure, and then it goes to deformation. It'll start deforming. So there's a little bit more of get out of the way before all of a sudden here comes a screw pin shackle at you at about 90 miles an hour. And it's, you know, when we're out there and the client's on the side of the interstate, it's tough when, you know, you've got to not only worry about what the vehicle is that are coming by you at 60, 70 miles an hour, but also how you've rigged the recovery and also how you've been able to protect yourself. And it's very, very important. So, you know, this side of what we do, we also build in England. We have a manufacturer, Michael Boniface, that we acquired some 15 years ago, and then Jean-Georges and Le Barley Duke, France. This gives us world support. Saudi Arabia, South Africa, Norway, Sweden, New Zealand, Australia, and we have distributors in all of these places, and we have even customers in China. That's very hard, because, you know, it's not so much in China, everything is socialistic, and it's not run by the government, or it is a lot of the businesses run by the government, but they are starting to get into the private sectors of ownership up on there. Taking this off, so I don't worry about the bus cell phones, anyway. The key thing that happened is our marriage started with DP Winch probably in the late 80s, when Mr. Pruitt, Don Pruitt, owned the company. He was a very tough and challenging person. Anybody here that was with the DP back at that time under Mr. Pruitt, very nice guy, very cordial. There was never, ever anything wrong with the DP Winch. And if you didn't think so, just ask Don. Okay? I just put a little end to that, you know, but anyway. He was very challenging, you know, to deal with, you know, in getting his product. But we recognize that the worm gear winch of the past with Ramsey, which built, you know, Ramsey, a century record, when Jerry Holmes, when the Holmes company got sold in 1972 to Dover, you know, they did the worst mistake that you can do. It became a big corporate entity, and they did what they call vertical integration. They tried to grow the business within the business. And the thing is we go back to what I told you, we're family-based, okay? And when you sit there and you take the corporate world and you don't get the person that has that family-based feeling in there, and you start doing things that doesn't, you know, that hurts your buyer, you start losing product share. And that's exactly what happened, you know, with the Holmes company and not having the right direction. So in the 1972, Ernest Jr. sells out to Dover. There's a guy named Jerry Holmes, his oldest son. He had three boys. And he was the lead engineer. And they did the first small hydraulic wrecker. And so that was 1973, 1974. And it was on a one-ton truck, and it actually articulated back and forth. And so now you got a boom that went up hydraulically and a boom that went out hydraulically. Today, you'd say, well, that's pretty slow. But back then, that didn't even exist. You had a one-ton Ford, 10,000 GVW. You put a Holmes 440 mechanical wrecker on it. They weighed 1,000 pounds. The truck weighed four, so it was 5,000 pounds total. You have a 5,000-pound payload because it's a 10,000 GVW truck. Now you went and put a hydraulic wrecker on it that articulated. You had a unit that was once 1,000 pounds. It's now 2,500 pounds, and now you're down to a 2,500-pound payload truck because it's a 10,000-pound truck, and the project came to this screeching halt because it was one too heavy, and it tipped over, you know, when the guy learned out how to use it. So, you know, Jerry said, well, we got to go back to the drawing boards and redesign it, and corporate world said, you've spent too damn much time with this thing. We're going to market with it, whether you're like. And Jerry says, okay, I quit. And that was the worst mistake they did, because Jerry went out and started Century Record. And it wasn't within 10 years that Century surpassed the Holmes company, because they remained what they were. They kept it in the manner, they lived by mechanical wreckers, they lived by what had been successful to give them 75-80% of the market, and they died by that very same. You always have to be moving forward, period. You know, today, yesterday, I was at Crosby, and I put challenges in front of Crosby. I mean, y'all know what snatch block is? You know, I mean, a snatch block, you take the cable from your winch, you go around to a snatch block, it's two things. It's either a mechanical advantage or it's a change of direction. And, you know, I said, and the snatch block's been around since, you know, we started pulling oil out of the ground. They've been around forever. That's what listed the sails, you know, on boats back in when Columbus, and prior to that, the Vikings, y'all had snatch blocks. You know, it's just, but now, today is a, snatch block is a tool that when Tom and I are doing our educations through all over the world, it's an absolute tool that's used every time during a recovery. If I can take life or use or abuse off of a winch and a cable, I'm going to train a guy to do it. It's not like you get your paycheck on Friday and you go spend it all, but, you know, whatever on Saturday. You know, you want to put a little bit of that money in the bank, keep it for, you know, a rainy day. Anyway, it becomes this point of the tour that they take these tools and we sell these tools all over the world and we become part of this family. And in that, all of the towers that are out there, and there's about 35,000 in North America alone, but if I go to Japan, if I go to the United Kingdom, if I go to South Africa, the problems are just the same. No matter where they are in our towing, it's always getting help, keeping that help because of the demand. That's the number one problem that's out there. It's always out there on there. So, and we're going to go through some of these presentations, and some of you guys can get familiar with what we want to do. So, if you just want to pop a couple of those, we run just about everything in my group. I do the medium and large wreckers, runs a DP winch. We have had offshore competitors bring your 50K and your 35K winch that they have knocked off into my place of business and say, I can sell this winch to you for $2,000. We've had competitors of yours come into our place of business to my buyers, which I don't control, and say, look, you can buy this Ramsey winch and we can save $1,200. And I fight every day to say that DP, Don Pruitt, love him, you know, is when they talk about a planetary winch, they don't talk about planetary winches. The tower out there uses DP. That's what they reference it to. You know, and that's what, and in my part of the line of the business, I want the path of least resistance, you know, and then also want somebody that I know when I got a damn problem, which I do, and I will pick up the phone and I will call Peter or Jeremy or someone else and say, like, what's going on, you know, with what's happening here, or how do we take care of this? Because that tower is 24/7, and they want to know how to get that O-ring fixed, you know, in order for the thing to shift correctly, or what's the issue because it's not pulling, or what's that sound? We came out with this model record about 12, 14 years ago. This is the Century 3212, which is also the Vulcan V30. This is a 16-ton unit. Now, as we talk about tonnage on tow trucks, you know, we made the recovery boom and the winch to what that overall cab and chassis, the gross vehicle weight is, and what am I expect to do? This is a point that we recognize when we designed this unit from ground one was the first change in the medium duty line that had been done since the 80s. And this wrecker right here was designed to do beverage trucks, single axle delivery vehicles, also tow an automobile down to the smallest Mini Cooper, what have you, and or up to an individual road tractor. Huge, huge range. You know, we specially designed the crossbar. We hand-built the crossbar. You can go out and buy a structured tube. Y'all are, you know, from the vendor, steel vendor, and it comes into there. Most of what we buy today is flat plate steel, you know, because it's high yield. It's T1, 100,000 or even better. And it comes in a just like a 4x8 sheet of plywood, and you run it through a CNC, a water jet, or a laser, or whatever, and then you take the time to fabricate it, because you can put structural strength in it where you couldn't before. Another thing is you leave the weight out. That's the biggest thing that's made Miller Industries successful is the weight of our overall trucks. For every pound that we're out there in this 16-ton unit, we are going to weigh less than our competitors because we all concentrate on the individual design of the wrecker as well as what do we weigh here and what do we weigh here. In the towing and recovery business, we are the only industry, and think about this, whether it's your pickup truck out there or Peterbilt that delivers product to you, every truck is designed to take the load and put it down between this axle and this axle, no matter what its design is. Matt, Pete, Kenworth, Freightliner, International, Navistar, whatever, that's what it's designed to. Dump truck, trash truck, mixer, packer, pumper, snorkel, you know, a road tractor, a trailer, a flow boy, they all go on a fifth wheel or they get mounted to the cabin chassis frame. 100% of the tower's load goes out here. Goes out here. And no individual has sat there and designed this truck for that load to be carried out here. And we're the only ones that do it. So what we call the gross vehicle weight rating is we have to make a lever. We all go back to the days when you were kids in elementary school. You know, you had a seesaw. Y'all remember that? Okay. I remember because I used to watch the girls. I was always on the girls' side, by the way, while watching the seesaw. But this is the seesaw right here. There, you're with me. I'm bringing the crowd into this, okay. So here's the seesaw effect. This is my fulcrum point. So from this point is my lever that keeps this on the ground and allows the tower to be able to steer properly. And then the other part is here is where I pick that load up and what I carry back here. And so that's why we have to have these trucks the length that we do. And when we design a wrecker to go on that cabin chassis, we design some of the weight of that wrecker to go here because we want weight here. We want the batteries, the engines, the fuel, and everything as far up forward as possible so we can do it. The reason for success with Miller is that we recognize that more than any of the other people. We work hard at it. The engineers do a great job as we, the sales guys, tell them what we look for. And then you work in that partnership between sales and engineering to come to with that product to the, you know, to the market. And then you have the marketing teams bring that unit out there to get the exposure that's necessary through trade shows, literature, you know, and the other tools. This runs the 15,000 pound DP winch that we've had. We've had some issues with the winch. We've had some free spooling issues with the winch. We also came back and told you guys how to better address the tensioner on there. You supply it with an air tensioner, and you also can supply it with a spring tensioner up on that point. And you know, the tensioner, are y'all familiar with the tensioner?
Oh yeah.
Okay, what is a tensioner supposed to do? And when is it designed to put the tension on the cable? When the cable's going in or going out? Going in. He says in. Everybody agree? Yes? You do? You're wrong. How many of y'all fish around here? Yeah, I got a fisherman, bass fisherman, right? So you got the fishing pole. Ladies, you all done this. You fishing. You take that fishing pole and you got that lure on there and you throw that fishing pole on there. Do you keep your thumb on the line as the lure's going out? Yes. And when the lure hits the water, do you take your thumb off it? Start bringing the line in? Yes. Yes?
Yes.
Okay. Hello? Yeah. If you take your thumb off before that lure hits the water, what happens to the line on the reel? Bird's nest. Exactly. Now, once you start bringing that line in, you have the friction of the lure in the water that actually puts the tension on the line that allows the line to go back on the reel correctly. The only thing that your thumb did was to keep that line when going out, that when that motion stopped, that reel stopped. And your thumb was the tensioner. The line going out. That's all it's good for. When a tower goes out there and he takes 175 feet of cable off of the drum, he pulls the casualty 25 feet, he has 150 feet of cable out, that tensioner does squat to bring that cable back in. Does nothing. You have to have a load at the end of that hook going over the shiv wheel of that wrecker in order for the cable management to be correct to go back on here. Tensioner does you nothing on that point. So that is a point where we teach a lot of what our towers do is keeping that cable management. There's nothing worse than having cable overlapping each other because it takes the life out of the cable, and it's bad for it. It's already sitting up there on the record getting the UV lights and suns on it over the long period of time. So the 15K has been in our family now for probably 15 years next. I believe we go to the 4024. This is our 20K model. Before this model started with the Ramsey H700, and as we got away from worm gear winches and went to planetaries, we put the 20K winch on here, and it's been a phenomenal winch for us. We use a lot of the 20K winches in our push bumpers. We do a lot of work in the city of Philadelphia and New York, and they want to put a 20K or a 15K winch in a very big, robust bumper up there to be able to pull something up with the truck just pulling up to it and not having to turn around. A lot of times in the inner cities, the challenges are a lot better than out here, you know, in Tulsa, Oklahoma, where you got a lot of room to make a turn. You get into Boston, Providence, Rhode Island, Newark, that inner city is tough, real tough. Okay, 20K, then here, our next winch, 25. This is our 5130 is a 25-ton wrecker with your 25,000-pound winch. We were just in a meeting prior to coming in here. It's the number one selling unit that we built, by far. And the reason is there's FET exemptions. FET is federal excise tax. It's 12%. If that wrecker cost $100,000, then this would be $12,000 in taxes, not sales tax, FET tax on this unit. And we get around the FET because we sell it as a single axle and we keep the gross vehicle weight rating of the cab and chassis below 33,000 GVW, and that's how we're able to do that. 25 tons. For going back even prior to Peter's age and mine, I've been in this business 40 years, is the Home 750 was the design. When you go to cities like Tulsa or either county or the state, they'll have requirements for the towers for medium, small, and large wreckers. And it's usually 10 ton, 16 ton, and 25 ton because they're still in the box of the Holmes product line from 40 years ago. But a 25 ton wrecker is a heavy duty wrecker in all 48 states. And that's why this 25 ton unit gets recognized. If you're going to do Oklahoma Highway Patrol work or Tulsa State Police work, city work, you know, then you've got to have a 25 ton wrecker. So the 25K, and part of the thing that we were talking about in this morning's meeting was, how many of you all were around here when we built the DP45? You remember all the DP45? Okay, and that got changed to the DP what? 50. And what did we do with the DP50 that wasn't over the DP45? Put gear set. Pull the gear set out so when we free spooled it, the winch, you know, the cable would be able to come out. I can't tell you, who was the sales guy prior to with DP back then that we dealt with? Prior to you, Peter.
Is it Gary?
I don't know.
Gary McLaughlin?
Oh, Cheryl. No, it isn't. I would call it because the DP45 not only had the problem of being able to pull the cable out, but when it got cold in the wintertime, and we've sold our customers this new 45, 50 ton integrated, the foam would ring off the wall because the oil that went into the DP45, that client could not pull out his 3/4 inch cable. They were pissed. And so Ramsey took your winch, knocked it off, made a 50K Ramsey winch, and the one thing they did was to make the free spool, so Toby Jones came to the plate, rescued DP, and that's how. It was about a month or a year's worth of aggravation right there in about this minute. But that's how the DP came about. Now, 50. But when we did the 50, what happened is now the cable came out too easily. So it would bird nest. It was just like the lure hitting the water and the line would keep going. We'll talk about that in just a minute. All right, let's go. The 7035, we lived in that family. The first winch we ever bought from DP was the 30K winch. It's what cut our teeth into the planetary business. It went on the first rotator we ever built. That was 1988. And a rotator is a recovery boom that rotates 360 degrees. It's a rotator, it's not a crane. Crane can't do what we can do with a rotator. And second of all, we don't want to use the word crane in our business. A whole lot of different regulations. more reach, more height, more boom, more capabilities than when our integrateds were in the earlier 5130s, 35,000 pound winch. We buy that in two different drum sizes. It all depends on where the winch goes, as to if it's a 10 and 3 quarter drum or a 14. But a real workhorse for us, a real go-getter. We sell this product in not only in the Century product line, but in the Vulcan, in the V70, using that 35,000 pound winch. As a matter of fact, in the Vulcan product, we've had your 22K, which was a military winch. It was your 20, we made it a 22. And we buried the 22, that military winch. What's that, Mom?
It's 22K,
I would hope it'd be a little bit more official than just a 22, but anyway. And it gets mounted under here, and it comes out of the tower, and it gets a third line. And do you think, does it, I can't make this wrecker, and I'm pretty good at making a wrecker sit still. I can't get this wrecker to sit still with two 35,000 pound winches, not alone add another 22K, and that we charge a client about $12,000 for. But they want it, so they got it, and they pay for it. As they got it, it's just one of those things, you got to have it. So anyway, the 9055 is next, and this is where we took that 50K winch. And the reason you see that strap that goes over that 50K winch is because two things, well, there was three things we did with this winch that made it a Miller winch, and that we get the proprietary. We put the strap over there to keep the cable from climbing out the outside. We put the two blocks at the bottom at 6 o'clock on the inside of the drum. And the reason we did that, because we sell this winch in a top wrap and a bottom wrap. And in an integrated wrecker, it's bottom. The cable's coming through the shiv, it's going here, and it wraps around the drum, so it's a bottom wrap. And that those blocks at 6 o'clock on the left and right lower part of that winch is to keep the cable from getting into the inside that direction. And that was a simple fix, but I can't tell you, when a tower would get out there and he wasn't paying cable management, he'd start winching, and the cable had come out over the drum and gotten in there, and then he's in a world of hurt, because now he's just broke the cable he's trying to do the recovery, or damaged it that he couldn't go ahead with the recovery. So now we had that winch that free spooled so well, the way we could slow it down is we took your tensioner that was designed to operate at 100 PSI, and we were cranking 120 PSI at it so that we were putting force in that down, because when we pull it out, the drum would not stop. And so you'd pull the cable out, the drum would continue, and the cable would get loose, and now the guy would do a hard pull, and the cable would go down between the other cable and would crush it, and now you threw the cable away. Because so that's when we went to the puck. So that one little simple puck, and this is a point where you don't build a mousetrap to fix a problem. Very low maintenance item. It's that 5/16 bolt that's on the side of the strap, that drum, that little disc rides on the side of the drum. We set that when we deliver the wrecker, and it's good for its life expectancy. That's become the number one bad boy winch in the market. We can put that winch on our rotators. We put it in the drag winches on the rotators. We put it in the Vulcan V100 and the Century 9055. And I will tell you, you can go down here if you've been in these neighborhoods where they drill water and gas lines. So they have this machine that goes and bores the ground. Y'all familiar with what I'm saying? And they'll bore that line in through the ground. And in Florida, that's a big thing. And they can run 1,000 feet when they run that bore line, and they'll pull that pipe. Well, the head of those lines sometimes will get off, because they do it with GPS, believe it or not. And if it runs into something that sends the GPS off, all of a sudden that pipe, because it's one big reel that they put together, will not end up where it wants, where it was supposed to be. And they got to pull it back. I'm talking 8-inch, 10-inch, 12, 16-inch, huge, plastic rubber piping that they're running, water lines or natural gas or what have you. And they'll use these wreckers. They'll call our clients, and they'll come in, and they'll back three wreckers up there, and they'll bury them down. And I'm talking burying them. And all three wreckers will hook onto that pipeline and pull it. And I've seen it where literally in the sand out of Florida, that you walk right off the ground and walk right up onto the tailboard of the top of that wrecker. That's how far it gets buried. But once that line starts coming, those boys don't quit. And depending on what that piping is, your cost is anywhere from $250 to up $1,000, for a linear foot. So they want it back. But that's the kind of what the, when I talk to the Johnsons out of Orlando, Coffs out of West Palm Beach, and we built the new 1150 rotator, which has been out about 2 years, and we put that 50K winch, they'll say that that winch will do everything that I've asked it to do. You know, so I'm comfortable with that winch going into one of my bigger recovery units being the 1150 on there. We run 3/4-inch cable, depending on where it's located, 200 to 250 feet. So it's a lifeline. All right, next. The rotators. Rotators are becoming big, real big. We, you know, introduced it in 88. The industry died till about 96. And then in 2000, rotators became an integral part. You're looking at about $550,000 up to $700,000 for what that machine's cost. The cabin chassis at about 150 to 190 grand, depending if it's a tandem or a single steer, is what you see right here. So let's go with the rotators. We've got several models. Here's the 1135. This is our smallest rotator that we built. We're going back to the 25, where the guy can option up to the 35,000 pound winch next. The 1140 came out because it was lightweight. We could take it anywhere in the states of California, and as long as we scaled 42,500 pounds, the gentleman could buy a permit up to 60,000 pounds. Not only is the recovery the critical part with our rotators and our big stuff, but we are the number one manufacturer when it comes to the recovery capabilities of this unit and the towing. Towing is a critical part to us. I'm not going to sell a guy a $400,000 to $700,000 rotator and it just be able to do casualties. He can't make the payment to be able to do that. He has to be able to tow this. And the nice thing about towing with a rotator is it's heavy up here. We designed it to be heavy, 20,000 pounds. So I can tow a mixer packer pumper snorkel truck off of the rear and keep 10,000 pounds for safe braking and steering with the rotator. And this underlift that's in the back is a design of that unit. That's very, very important where you give the design of that machine multiple purposes for our clients. And again, the reason why we're number one in the rotator business throughout the world and why the military has selected us. Okay? Let's go back to 1135. The 1130 for the military, and you guys played a critical part for us, went back. We delivered 400 of these to the United States Marine Corps 5 years ago. We were building a rotator every 88 minutes. Every 88 minutes, a complete rotator went down our assembly line, and you guys supplied us the winches on there. There was a 50K winch that was down here in the belly in this, and at every 88 minutes, a station moved. And then we loaded that load boy, that wrecker on the load boy, and it went to West Point, Mississippi, where it then went through a process as they built the MRAP vehicle. And that got shipped over to Afghanistan. Y'all familiar with MRAPs, the military? You know, an MRAP came out about 10 years ago. And what was an MRAP designed for? Yeah, right, exactly. So what you had is the Hummer. Y'all know the Hummer, right? So the military lived off of the Hummer. So every National Guard place has got Hummers in here. You buy a Hummer, you know, with just a canvas top or no top, or you can get it with some form of radar or maybe a 50 caliber up on top. The Hummer was very, very vast in the various models. It was high, it had great clearance, could go anywhere. All right. Now a Hummer, you know, costs the military $40,000 to $60,000, depending on what model it was. And a Hummer weighed 5,000 to 9,000 pounds, considering what was the model that it did. Well, now you come over here and we get into this Middle East conflict and you get all these IEDs and it becomes somebody's brainchild to build this MRAP vehicle. Quickly, they just put laden pieces of steel around the doors and stuff like that. But then you had Oshkosh and Max Pro and Force One Protection that built the MRAP vehicle. And they designed that vehicle with, you know, body panels underneath of it that were V'd. So when they hit that IED, the explosion went out. Didn't go up, and the individual that was in there would hopefully save it. But I want to tell you, when 17 pounds of TNT goes off and you're sitting inside a cabin that's mind protected, your brain takes one hell of a shock. Hell of a shock, I'm just telling you. And the MRAP vehicle, now the standard MRAP vehicle, and we're going to show you some pictures of that, where that Hummer was 5,000 to 9,000 pounds, where that Hummer was $40,000 to $70,000, now we sat there and supplied the troops with an MRAP vehicle, the cost went from $300,000 to $500,000, and the weight went from 5,000 to 9,000 to 28,000 to 40,000 to 70,000 pounds. And all of Oshkosh's and all of those winches that you supplied Oshkosh on the Hemet, and therefore here comes the military and they say, we need this rotator. We pitched this rotator to them for 2 years and they just snubbed us. The smallest record that we had to be the lightest to go on a road structure that didn't exist in Afghanistan. It didn't exist. And we said, we can build this at 48,000, 50,000 pounds, put it on this all-wheel drive Navistar, sell you this wrecker in quantities that will allow you to properly put them where they need to do and get these guys out of harm's way. Now, when that Hummer, when that MRAP hit an IED and it blew up because of the impact of the shields going out there, what happened to the front tires? So now you had this vehicle with no front tires on it and disabled. $300,000 to $500,000. Weighing 28,000 to 45,000 pounds, with all of the latest of GPS and fire suppressants and all of that, do you think they just leave that thing behind? Huh?
No.
No, you don't. So you know how what they had to do to get rid of it? In the old days with the Hummer, you could take a phosphorus grenade, throw it into there, and it would what? It pretty much destroy the Hummer. But this is a mine-resistant vehicle. You don't throw no, you know, hand grenade into an MRAP vehicle and do shh to it. Just doesn't happen. So now you go get a $65 million F-18 and you fire a $250,000 rocket to blow the damn thing up. You know, and they're going like, well, this makes no sense. So therefore the rush for that 1130 that went into that market. And it was the rush. It was unbelievable to do that. But it was the fastest deployment in the mechanized warfare of any type of vehicle that was ever done in the history of the military. Very neat to be a part of it. And you guys were part of that process. Okay, let's go. Go. 1150, number one seller. Here's our big boy, five axles, about 700 grand. Six winches. We got the 22s on the side. The military winches you saw on your Oshkosh for your recovery vehicles, the 60K winches. This new family of winch, if something isn't coming, something's going to break. As this winch will flat pull, it almost reminds me of the Holmes 850. And then we would have anywhere between, in this case, two 35,000-pound winches. So there's six winches on this machine. Most of our rotators come with 150, but in this case, you can do dual 35. Excuse me, dual 35s in the belly. Those are my workhorse winches. When we do our training schools, we talk about this winch being my money winch. This is the winch that we teach so hard that creates the hard pull in the recovery. Because if you extend this boom out, and the further this boom goes out, the longer the lever. Okay? If I've got a 200-pound rock in my field, and I go take a hammer, just a regular hammer, and stick that hammer underneath that 200-pound rock in the field, do you think I'm moving it? Huh? No. What do I do? What do I go get? A longer pry rod, right? Something 6-7 feet long. So it's a longer lever. Gives me better leverage. Sometimes it's a good thing. Gives me more reach, more height, more ability to pick. But when I run that boom out, that lever also unstabilizes the very vehicle that got it to where it's going. So, you know, it's very, very critical in our training aspect that we talk about how can you minimize the impact of the load going over this shiv to these two 70, 60, or 50K winches, whatever, and how can I keep this lower center of gravity? The lower to the ground, the more stabilization that unit has. So, all right, next. Okay. All right, how's that one? Better? All right, now to get into the point where the recovery side of things, and this is what the guys live for. This is a road tractor trailer that's up underneath there. This is off the side of Interstate. This is actually up in the northern part of Oklahoma, Arrow Towing. All right, let's flip it. How am I doing with time? We're good. We're an hour. We're good. Good? Good time? Now, look, here's the load. Now, here's the key thing that a tower will that we teach them. Can I cut the straps and take all that weight off there and then recover the vehicle? And then I'm left to pick up all the, ever pick up 600 pieces of 2x10s laying on the side of the interstate? You think that's fun? Absolutely not. Now let me tell you one other thing. You know, we just had a new president, and one of the things that they talked about was law enforcement and, you know, supporting law enforcement. You talked about the number of lives that we lost in the year 2016 to law enforcement. In law enforcement and fire combined, per capita, we lose more tow truck drivers every year in the last 11 years than law enforcement and fire. Do you know that? You know where they lose their life? Side of the road. Doing their job. And you've all seen these accidents or the, you know, cop cameras where he's out there doing something and another vehicle slams into him or does whatever. You know, texting, when you see that, you have a whole new perspective about texting or being on the phone and not paying attention to what you're doing. Drinking, getting tired, you know, we've all been there. I'm just telling you, this boy is now putting his life on the side, not only in jeopardy with the recovery that he's doing, but also in that point of those human missiles. And that's why we've created the Move Over Law. And that's why every time you see a car carrier or a small wrecker, I want you, or a law enforcement guy, have the respect to get your butt over, you know, one lane, because it just gives them that little bit more room of safety. It's a federal law now. You know, if you're unable to do it, you're not going to get in trouble, but get that respect. And as the more that you start doing it, making that turn signal and moving over, the people behind you will start learning why. It just educates everybody. Okay. So what we're going to do is we want to do this recovery and be able to get this thing back up on its wheels, and we want to keep it strapped. Okay, next. You can see there's, do you think picking these up on the side of the road is going to be fun? Ain't happening. You know, and then it's just more time that you're out there and the more pointed. So we have to do a rigging job that's going to come over. Now, how many of you all have a fireplace at home? How many of you all build a fire, right? How do you carry the fire wood into your house?
Carry it like this. Huh? You look pretty. If you had a girlfriend with you, you wouldn't have her probably much longer. If you carry it. Right? So, you know, you carry the firewood in like this, you know, and that's the way you do it. So when we're teaching the school, when I'm telling the guy's going to do the wreck, if you look at the tires and you see the tires and you've got to, the tires are closest to the wrecker, is that easier or harder? Is it easier or harder? And because of this, is that harder? Right? And that's what's going to happen here. The wrecker is going to be over here, and he's going to have, because this is a ditch. The road's here. So he's got to now go over here and take this 18-wheeler and pick it up. And it's going to be a lot harder. The weight's further away. The lever is working against me on there. Okay? Let's go. So we're going to take, we've got to take a cable, and just like a spring, we've got to go from this side underneath this load and come back over here, because we want the cable, the strap, the recovery tool to work for us too. If I just take a line and I hook it right here to my wrecker, this is not going to get me what this gets me to take the load off of the wrecker. We want to wrap that load, we want to keep that load on the trailer, and also we want to create a mechanical advantage by creating a spring effect with the strap. Next. 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 So you're getting to see the program, tow truck's pulling up. This is an 1140 rotator, so we got 35K winches and 50K winch in the belly. Next. And that's it. See the booms going up? Boom's going up, that's the lift. He's come around the load, and he's come back over here, and he's created. He's got one block going to here, and we're gonna use the drag winch in a minute. And the other cable's getting ready to come next. Okay, so we're wrapping the load. We're wrapping the load. The next tool he's gonna bring in is air cushions. And he's gonna put an air cushion right in here, and it inflates with low pressure air, 5 to 11 pounds. Just this big bag that'll float, and it'll push that load back in there, and it's going to help him on the recovery. Next. Next. So we should get a little bit of a picture up on there. Bringing in the other wrecker. It's got two on there. One more.
All right? So now what we've got is we've got a load that's coming up here. And experienced operator, in the heat of the moment, screw up. He's crisscrossed his lines, and it happens so often that when you're in the heat of the moment and you're trying to get the job done, you just don't pay attention to a simple little point up on there. But he's got it. He's got one strap here, one strap here. He's going to bring the other wrecker up in here to work with the front of the vehicle. Let's go. There you go. Now you see he's starting to roll it back in. See the cushion? You can barely see the cushion right up in there where he's taken that air cushion and helped him push that load. But now he's got the load because he's got a lot of tension going around those endless loop straps. Okay? All right? And what we've come to now, the other wrecker is going to do the same thing up in the front. We're going to wrap it. Go ahead. And tighten it up. Go ahead. And go ahead. And go ahead. One more time. Here we go. We start coming up. All right? Let's go. Just keep right on going. There we go. And here's the biggest thing. Look, I am now recovered. If I unhook, what's he going to do? Challenge every time. That 3 to 4 feet of shoulder on the side of the road or the interstate is one of the biggest nemesis for a tower. This job is done, but it's not really done. So what he's going to do, he's now going to take this wrecker, he's going to move it forward, and here comes the rotator key. He's going to take that boom, and as this boy winches that truck back up, you see the cable going out here to the rim? As he's going to pull this truck forward about 100 feet, he's going to winch this vehicle to him, and as he winches this, this boom is going to follow it in order to keep that tractor trailer from going back over. This is where rotators have really kicked in. And the other thing is, interstate's open, okay? And that's why Federal Incident Management love these rotators, because they can at least have one lane open and get that traffic flowing. All right, let's go. Okay, one more time. And he takes this back home. There it is. It's winched out, up forward on the road. And he actually delivers this load to the job site the next morning. Cool, huh? All right, let's go. Let's go to a couple more. Let's go. Recovery 2. This is a bad boy right here. And this is where you get out of the box. This is what I talked to Crosby yesterday on, and the boys up front in the office this morning with the DP product. Got to get out of the box. The winch has been the same for this long period of time. We got to go somewhere new. Okay? I need a new tool. I need a tool to sell my clients. So here's a tractor trailer. The interstate's right here, and it just looks like he's run out into the field, doesn't it? Huh? Sounds pretty easy. This is about 200 feet off the road. Now you know why we need cable capacity on your drums. But what's this? How in the hell, did this road tractor get here and this boy is back here? And he's parallel to the road. All right, next picture. Look at that. Look at that. You can walk right underneath there. Now you start to go back. Yeah, go front forward. All right, you can see that he went through the ditch. And it went back and put the reefer and everything. This is loaded with, I think it was like 55,000 pounds of pork in the back. Now, you can tell real quick, the way he's bundled up, it's cold. Okay? Snow and raining, whatever it is, these boys are going to be out there and girls are going to be doing the job. Okay? So the key thing is we got to watch my reefer temperature because we're going to try to save this load. Okay? So the cold temperature out there is going to help us. But I got to get that bad boy over that ditch next. There you can see the damage to the reefer, how it went back in there. So it's not running. It's out of context. Next. There it is. All right. Next. Next. So do we always do everything with a big wrecker? No. In this situation, he's taking his 2 4-wheel drive Dodges with your little I think this is the 12,000-pound winch that's on here, and he's running the Vulcan 894. And he's got two cables on here, but he's only going to use one of them. All right, so let's go. Next picture. Now you can see what we're doing is we're actually taking a line and making it three parts. Why am I doing that? We teach this as we do it. When your 50,000-pound winch, when it has the sixth layer of the cable up on there, anywhere near them right here. All right, so here's your drum, okay? And you got your your barrel, and here's your drum. Cable, 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 cable. So there's six layers. The longer this goes up, the longer the lever is, and the longer that lever is trying to pull that winch when it's trying to go that way, taking the capacity away from you. The more cable on a winch, the less it works. Anybody know what the rated capacity of a DP50 is on the sixth layer? 26,300 and some odd pounds. What's the rated winch here? We call it a 50 because it's, and so I've lost half of the capacity of that winch because I have almost or all of the line on it. If I can get the line off of it, what does the winch become? More powerful, stronger. And so that's why I'm using one out to the casualty, back to the truck, and back out to the casualty, because I've gotten horsepower into my winch. Okay, next. All right, got two trucks down there. We're going to make the turn. What's this? Being able to take this 80,000 pounds and be able to winch it to us, but we want to lift it. We don't want to drag it into the ground. The tower wants lift, and so he's taking it. Look here. Here we go. Multi-parts of cable coming out, and then he hooks a hook to a deadline because he's got more cable out on one winch, but he needed a little bit more. This is another training tool that we talked about. So boy did a great job on this. All right, let's go. All right, we're starting to come up. Come on. Starting to come up. Come on. Starting to come up. Look at the cables move. Cables are going to start moving now. We're going to go away from the front axle. We're going to the drive axles, and now we're going to go back to the back of the trailer. All right, let's go. See, and we're taking him back to the back of the trailer. He's going between the two wreckers. All right, let's go. Right up in there. See, we've moved the cables back. This guy's up here along for the ride. Have a good time. You know? All right, let's go. And then up onto the road. One more time. Bingo. You're good to go. Slick. And then when things like this go well, like this, and you know, this is a good day. You've now taken this, you'll lift up the back of this trailer, put it in here, hook it to the wrecker, whoosh, down the road. All right, let's go. Next, there you go. One more time. Recovery number three. That's a pretty cool one. That's right there, I think. Yeah. All right. Here's a good one. This is right on the interstate. This is out of Council Bluff, Nebraska. This is a fire truck that he's bought that he now carries his equipment. And so we use a lot of that. We just bought a Bud Light, and we call it the Bud Light trailer. The only thing it doesn't have is refrigeration for the Bud Light. But we have a 16-bay Bud Light trailer with your product and all of the tools from Crosby that we take to our training schools, because there's never the correct tool that you have. We end up adding and adding and adding and adding chains and blocks and tools and shovels and pry bars and saws and metal saws and wood saws and chainsaws and all kinds of stuff, so that generator, water, when you get there, be able to pump off the diesel fuel. All these guys, that's what they'll have in here. So this bad boy, sometimes they'll say, before you do anything, I want the fuel out of this truck. So he's got a means of being able to do that, usually an older fuel tank and a pump system, and he'll drain the diesel, especially if it's starting to leak up on there. All right, let's go. This is a good one. Laying out there, container. Container's robust, so you can do it. That other trailer that we had in the other two pictures, they're not robust. Container, I got pretty good pick points. We, you know, tow her real quick, that's uneducated, we'll go right here to these pockets. Mistake number one, because we haven't done what? Wrapped the load. We want to wrap that load. So that's what Tony's going to do in this one. They're actually going to dig out this corner. In order to get that out, we're going to take this wrecker, we're going to lift the back of that trailer to get this up out of the ground so I can take that strap and pull it up. All right, let's go. You're going to see your drag winches into work here. All right, let's go. Let's go. Let's go. All right, so that's what we're doing. We're going to get this up in the air so we can get the strap, come around the frame, start doing this. All right, let's go. Let's go. We lifted it. See, we've got it lifted in the air. Now you can see the sunlight going underneath there, and I'm going to put my strap. Okay? Let's go. All right. Drag winch. Drag winch coming from the back of the wrecker down to the D-ring, going back up here to this axle to get this load, because this boom is up. It's going to want to unstabilize this truck. This is my horsepower pull because it's the drag winch. And I'm what we're calling kneeing it, taking that cable and pushing it down. The other thing it does is it drives these tires down into the ground so it doesn't skid. Very critical on that. Another thing we teach. All right, go ahead. All right, we got the cable, got it down up underneath there. What do we got in this one? I want you to watch what we're going to do here. We're going to do what we call a walking snatch block. All right, let's go. Let's go. There's that line. And that, look, this is a lever. And this is what we teach the guy. The easiest thing for him to do is most of the towers would have come right here and tied off right here because it's at eye level. Okay? From the ground to here is 98 inches. That's what the width of the tire is. Might be 101. If I come down here, it's 85. If I go up here on top with my hardware, I'm up there at about 110. I've added 30% more to my lever, and in this situation, I want the lever to work for me, so I've taken the cable and run it up here, put it on this block of wood, I take that chain and I do a 360, so when I pull on it, it actually forces that 4x6 into this tire, keeps it from rolling off, and I've taken a lever from here to here, I've gotten 30% more leverage in order to start bringing that truck over. I'm taking the load off the wrecker on that point. All right, let's go. All right, so what we've got here is we've got two straps that are coming up here, and I think we will be able to see this a little bit better. Take to the next picture. One more, there's the knees down. One more, starting to come up. Oh, it just doesn't show it. Let me see, one more picture. It didn't show it, daggone it. What we do is let's go back then. Let me see if I can identify it. We put that snatch block from Crosby, take it down, about three back. Keep going, one more. I think we're right here. So what we've done is, here's a strap coming to the block, here's another strap coming to the block, and we take this walking snatch block, and we have a choker. And so what it's done is, it finds on its own the center of the pull. That snatch block will pull up and find what length. You might have 3.5 feet on the choker here and 4.5 feet, but it finds center on its own, and that's what we call a walking snatch block. And therefore, I got the same amount of pull here as I do here. All right, so bing, bing, bing. Pretty slick. Tight quarters, you know, on an entry wrap doing a, 270-degree circle in order to get it around. Lot of talent. I'm just telling you, when you get up that close to a wrecker, you know, and doing that type of recovery, it's a challenge. All right? Okay? All right. Let's go. Let's go one more. Let's just get us. There it is. There it is. Okay? See what we've done? There's that choker. There's the walking snatch block. It's equalized the pull here, and it's equalized the pull there. Now, this is a 17-ton Crosby screw pin shackle, and because we started this pull over here, the way we educate these guys is it's center line, 30 degrees from the center of this to rate it to full capacity, 17 tons. If you go to the side, because it's a screw pin, and it's holding it together, it's just not a pin with a mechanical clip to hold it into place, the rating of this block drops in half. So it became an 8.5 ton screw pin shackle. A lot of rigging, master links, taking a hook to a hook, and you know, these are all things that you can see that we've done the same, that Tony's done the same also here in the back. Another big thing is, we always teach that when you're using a chain, you don't hook the chain here and hook the chain here. Create a complete loop so that you keep the money in the bank. That's the whole purpose up on there. All right? Okay, cool. Back up on the road and out they go. Next one. Keep going. All right. Another challenge here, soft side trailer, a lot of work. All right? Same situation here that we've got. Notice the booms get up in the air. The booms are up in the air to create the leverage for the lift. Look at the snatch block lines. It really makes Tom and I feel good when we ask these towers to get us pictures from the recovery. And they take the very tools that you've taught them and they properly use them. just it really does, and you know, it makes their life a lot easier too, because then they get the job done, gets the reputation out with the local law enforcement and the other people here. Rotators have really, really, really helped on this part of casualty. Not everybody's got two rotators. Here the situation is you got two separate companies. So keeping friends sometimes is tough, but it's the challenge that you like to do, all right? Okay, and this is where we talk about wrapping, taking that tire and wrapping it, and that was just a big explosion of what I showed you earlier on the other one, okay? Okay. Sydney was broken this bad boy up. All right, this is some of the stuff that we did up at Fort Lee. So this is taking military vehicles. Some of the vehicles have been trashed or whatever. But then not only do they get at a point of, they'll fill it up and you can see the rear tires are mired down into a thing and they want you to do some recoveries. But the hardest thing to do is to create a wreck. Truck driver does it in 3 to 5, 10 seconds. And you know, they just go, oh shit. You know, and then we got to go out there and try to simulate one, and you go, I don't want to get dirty. Are you kidding me? Make a wreck, but all right, let's go. Let's see what we got here. Let's see. Keep going. I don't know what we're doing here. That's a Mr. Luciano. Let's go a couple more pictures. This is something. Again, you know, it's really, really critical in dealing with the military, you know, that we show them correctly that point of making that loop with your hardware and, again, the blocks. You know, we want to sit there and do this. Now, we're with this bad boy, if you remember, if we go three back, his ass was buried, you know, in that lake. So we've got to go into the lake, get his hardware. Now, the nice thing about military vehicles is because they're airlifted, transported, tied down, secured, you know, whether it's in an aircraft or on a boat, they have some very, very robust 4-to-1 safety factors of low points, always at the rear of the vehicle and at the front. So when it comes to recovery, they're some of the easiest ones to get. A lot more challenge when you're working with a Pete Kenworth Freightliner. This is designed to be aerodynamic and, you know, have a lot of plastic on it. All right, let's go. And that's what we're doing, a little bit of lift. We're running the drag winch and creating a little bit of lift. So we're lifting with these two lines and we're pulling with this line, okay? And you can see what's coming with it. You're bringing half the damn pond, you know, with it up in there. So it's, and we're relatively close, but a lot of the times we talk about getting away from, you know, being, if he was parked right here with the wrecker, that would be worse. By moving it further down there, gets more cable off there, and the other thing is it allows casualties. And when we were in Afghanistan and doing some of the trials and recoveries up on the mountain trail, you'd have a trail. I just tell you that it was a little challenging being in Afghanistan or in that type of environment because you never knew who your friend was. But you'd have these mountain trails and you know, you'd lose a vehicle down in here and you'd have to take the wrecker, here'd be my wrecker, and put the boom out, go down and get him up. Well, you get him up to here and it's just like that last 3 or 4 feet of that interstate. The hell do you do with them now? There is no such thing as a tree in Afghanistan, okay? You know, we talk about the famous Holmes tree. You know, what do you have here? You got a pole here and stuff like that. They don't even know what electricity is over there to have a pole to tie to. So it really becomes critical as to laying your plan out before you start executing your plan. Okay, just executing it. All right, let's go. Cool, just keep right on coming. We'll get this bad. And let's go back here to the pictures. We talk about, you know, low pulls to the D-ring. And you can see, you know, where these lines are visibly going to. These are very strong anchor points. These cast D-rings came from the Holmes Company and done in the 40s. We still use them today. For the military, we had to go and do a pull test on these D-rings. At 200,000 pounds, the D-ring did not fail. The very wrist pin that held the D-ring actually pulled part, breaking the casting up on there. So you can put a lot of power on there. You get 200,000 pounds, you never have that wrecker be able to sit. you know, and have that kind of pull. So very much safe when it comes to the working relationship to the capacity of the winch, working with those tieback points. Okay. Another good situation here, and you can actually have a recovery vehicle recover itself, and that's what we're training. Because the rotator has the means of doing a recovery over the front of the vehicle, over that cab, you can rotate that boom 180 degrees and actually go and recover yourself. Now, as you can see right here, if he's doing that, and he pulls this line down there and he starts tightening this line, what's going to happen to the front of this vehicle? It's going to drive it into the ground. Exactly. So what does he want to do? Exactly. So he wants to come up here, he's using this as a dead man, and then come back and tie it to the vehicle. And when you tie it to the vehicle, you actually get in the mud and you go behind the vehicle and you bring your chain up underneath that axle on that spring. So when you tighten it, what does it do? Lifts it up. Exactly. So try to sit there and make it, you know, a lot more user, you're not fighting yourself. Just a little bit, a few of the tricks that, you know, you end up doing. But this is one of the neat things that we were, you know, what we did is that wrecker. Now, it also in that mountain pass up there that we're talking about here is we could have the casualty sitting right here. And now the wrecker comes around here and he'll just rotate that recovery boom. And he'll actually do the barrel roll to put him up in the air and then lift him like a wheelbarrow and just take him up to the point where he can get him and get in front of him and pick him up. So we teach a lot of that aspect of being able to recover that vehicle from over in the front. All right, let's go. Another good pull that you see, here's your MRAP vehicle that we're talking about. Here's the deployment of the one of the 400 units that was done, the 1130. And this was the very reason was because now this Hummer at 5,000 to 9,000 pounds and $40,000 to $70,000 is, and this is about 40,000 pounds right here. It's about $300,000. Carries 8 guys. You know, you can buy how many school buses, carry a lot more kids than what this is. And what I mean, I'm unstuck. Same thing, gonna lift it. Go ahead. Same thing. Bring it on up. Now, this is a good one where we're doing a recovery. This is actually a blown up machine. And now you can see that the neat part about being able to work with the rotator off to the side at 90 degrees. And that's why the rotator is such a popular item, because no longer is the rotator the steering wheel with the driver positioning in it. You can leave the truck in its place and position the recovery boom to exactly what you want to do and be able to do that casualty. All right. Okay. And there's just, you can see all of the sophistication that goes into these vehicles that is safety, communication, jamming. That's a big thing that they do is they jam because, you know, GPS, they don't want their signal to be able to come down for that guy to sit up there and put a laser on them and then fire a rocket at them and then it hit the vehicle. So they actually jam that signal up in there. So all of that stuff needs to be recaptured. So that was the point of instead of taking that F-16, F-18 and firing that $250,000 thing and blowing this bad boy up, is you had these wreckers to be positioned throughout Afghanistan to be able to go get them. All right. Get another hard pull. That's tank. An Abrams AR-1. How much pound? How many do you think there? Lot. You know, and then they take it and disarm it, you know, don't let anything, won't fire it up and do the tracks, and they want you to pull it and bring it out of that bar. That's what they call a tier 3 recovery. So if it's up to the top of the track, they feel that that's the worst case scenario. And they always look at, and I don't know what this actual tank weighs, I'm going to guess somewhere around 180,000 to 200,000 pounds. So in the military, they had this formulation that if it's depending on level of tier 1, 2, or 3, if it's 3, then it was 3 times the overall weight of the vehicle. And that's about as bullcrap as you can get. 600,000 pounds, there's no way that that wreck would be able to move 600,000 pounds. It just wouldn't happen. And that's why you got to learn how to get that load up off of the vehicle you know, and make the lift and the pull easier than what it already, you know, could be challenging you. Okay. All right, let's go. And here's another perfect example. Again, the MRAP vehicle. We did a lot of this, and here's another MaxPro MRAP vehicle that's been brought back, and it's had the front end blown off of it. And so this is a real-world environment, what these guys would have to do as far as go get this casualty that's been, you know, blown up, no matter where is its place. Now, this is staged, but it's definitely a challenging stage in what they do, because you've got to lift it up over that berm, and then you've got to control it once it starts coming down so it just doesn't roll into you. So there's a lot here that's meeting the package that, you know, you're not familiar with. 225,000 pounds, they, you know, we didn't run the 35,000 pound winches in this program, and I can tell you right now that any tower that actually acquired this in the domestic market will tell you, pound for pound, the 1130 and now the 1135, we put larger cylinders and reinforced the mast, is probably the best machine that we have, because you can do everyday towing with it. You know, it weighs about 50,000, 54,000 pounds. So I can go tow a tractor trailer, and yet I can get the same revenue as a rotator when it becomes to the recovery side of it. So that was the whole point of this. And Tom and I knew after we did all of this, you know, Marine Corps and military training, just what this machine could do. And the nice part about it is I got a lot of weight here. I'm weighing about 24,000 on that steer axle. So we're doing lift. We got three lines going to it. Drag winch, main line coming back up into here. And again, because it's a military vehicle, I'm using the roof points as far as getting a pick and a lift. So again, that military vehicle adds a lot more opportunities to us than what you would see in the domestic side of everything. Okay? Now you're seeing your lift. So you're getting your lift, we're lifting, and we're pulling. And then we just control that lift once it gets done over on here. I think it's, is that in? What do we got on there? Okay. Let me pop those lights back up. Cool? You know? I don't have a script, you know. When I get out there and we're at demonstrations in Florida and California and Las Vegas, and you get in front of it, if you know what the hell you're doing, being able to communicate what the machine's going through should come to you naturally. You know, when you watch the presidents, you know, that's where Barack Obama was going, because he was excellent reading from a teleprompter. You know, and George W. Bush just wasn't. And I don't know what Donald Trump does yet, besides tweeting, you know, to see how that goes. But he doesn't care what he says, in case you didn't realize it. But it's going to be fun. It's going to be fun. But, you know, being able to talk about your product and in your case, it would be the winch and all that. When the guys get out there, you know, these are the key things that you're comfortable with. If you know what you're doing, you're able to actually, you know, present it and market it correctly. Going back to what I said a little bit earlier, the towing side of this, you know, yeah, we're the big boys. We're the top of the heap. We don't want to talk about our percentage that we are in the marketplace at all. We don't want to do that. But, you know, we're definitely kicking everybody's butt. But the key thing is when you're on top, you only have one way to go, and where is it? Somebody's sitting there knocking at your daggone ankles all the time. So, you know, my point of being at Crosby yesterday, taking one of those very tools, and my point of meeting with the team last night at dinner, and then coming in and saying, now that we've, you know, you didn't have those two Bud Lights, can we talk about exactly what you mentioned last night, and what can we do for DP to make you, well, you know, we're there. You know, I think I gave them three good points that can take us into, and one of the points was, well, both of the points, two of the three points, really, it's already there, you know. And I use an expression, I ran the plant floor with 500 guys, and I would have monthly meetings with my guys. And none of the plant managers had ever done that, and I didn't go to school to be a plant manager. You know, so learning the plant and its operation gave me a very good feel about what does it cost, what's your margins, how's it all exactly work up on there. But one of the things that I wanted, I was not good at what I did if I didn't communicate with the very people that achieved the goal that we looked at to get.
You know, those guys on the plant floor were just important to me as the CFO and the CEO and all of that other stuff. I'm just a spoke in the wheel, as is the expression that I do. And if I can communicate, and so what we did here and what Tom and Pat allowed us to put up in front of you guys is to give you a perspective of what you built. And what we do is we take, as Jeremy and Peter will do, when we go to the training schools and we go to the trade schools, and we're in front of all these people, we bring the boys and girls from the plant and actually put them in front with our customers, let them meet the people, let us see what we do as a sales team, let them understand what that D-ring does or what your DP winch is capable of doing and how that snatch block, so that when they're building the machine, they understand it. You know, the routing of the hoses, you know, how can we get the maximum performance, is the weld correct before we put it on something? If you see something wrong, you stop the line. You know, it's a critical part. You know, as I walked through Crosby yesterday, if you want to talk about an antiquated manufacturing facility, just go over there. You know, and it's kind of like what we had, is we had 350,000 square feet that had been there since 1982, and we had to create a flow process through something that was already built. Challenge. You know, but we did it, because the expense of going doing something new is almost impossible. And the other thing is you got to be able to keep running as you're making a change. You know, you still have to do business to pay the bills as you're going through a major change. In our situation, we created a new 80,000 square foot building that we moved small record to. That gave us 80,000, 60,000 about in 7 moves that we've moved each department, because we now had that vacancy. And that allowed us to be able to, as we shut a part down, we would have that paint, and then we'd move them over there, and we start on that guy. And it's tough, production control. Any of y'all in here involved in production and control? That's a thankless damn job. But the one that gets the most attention, because if you don't have it, guess what you don't do? You don't get it built, do you? You know, so, you know, and these were all the things that when I'd have the monthly meetings and everything, I wanted to do exactly what you guys did right here, which is you did it annually. I did it monthly when I'd have the meetings. And the first time I did it, the only thing I had to create a T-shirt, a hat, and a Walmart coupon, a few other things that I gave, was a FedEx box. It just happened to fit everything, and FedEx paperwork, I mean, boxing with closet, just happened to be outside my office. I said, this will work. So 8 o'clock, I walked out there, got all the guys together, talked about what we do, and then I recognized the 4 guys, and I had 4 FedEx box. So when we did it, it became a FedEx package. You know, I just was promoting FedEx, and that's how it all went. Every time that we would do that, and recognized an employee that went in up and beyond the call of duty. And then the other thing is you know, again, going back there, is you listen. You know, issues from manufacturing actually don't come from the engineering guy. We have that point that if the employee has a problem, he has the ability to get his team leader, or as an engineer is coming over there, to go and communicate. Now, you might think that's no big deal, but I promise you, there's manufacturing facilities that just doesn't allow to happen. You know, you do what you're supposed to do, and you create your paperwork or do whatever, and then you hope it's heard. There's nothing more frustrating to that guy in install and dress out in assembly that at the same time has to do something over and over and over again, and knows that he or she could do it better if it was just recognized that, you know, the change was there to go there. In our situation, it's a lot more involved because we're building something that's, you know, a lot, it's tougher. When you do ramp-ups, you know, right now in the trucking industry, you can get a brand new Peterbilt or Kenworth in 3.5 weeks. Never. That means that's a lot of things that go into that Peterbilt or Kenworth or Freightliner in 3.5 weeks to enter an order, and then 3.5 weeks have that bad boy come. Normal, in the old days, they would run anywhere between 6, used to be the minimum. Sometimes your lead times were 12 weeks. And they ramp it up. Well, they've kept it. The reason it's 3.5 weeks is they've tried to keep all of their employees anticipating over the last 4 years. We've run a
consistent but flat line manufacturing process. I mean, it increased, almost been, you know, negligible. But they don't want to lose the very people that they've, you know, got into these positions as far as training. So that's why the expeditious, you know, point of seeing that vehicle in 3.5 weeks. Everybody recognizes in manufacturing that the number one expense and the number one challenge is what you guys, us, me, everybody that's in this room, and retaining that, keeping that, and offering, you know, the proper, you know, tools to, for you all, medical bill, whatever it is, you know, to stay there. That's the toughest thing. And communications back to the floor was always my point. We had been blessed here with a very, very strong market, too good. Right now, Ed Miller, if I were to sell one of those $700,000 machines, I'm 7.5 months before delivery from start to finish. And my guy's gonna go to Jordan or NRC or find something else that isn't going to allow it to happen through his distributor. And that's not a good thing. It's a good thing to be that far out. You know, I can sit there and plan for him, so he's got his 2017 goal. What else do you compete with, by the way? Let me sit there and help. I'm just kidding. Are you taking me to dinner for that? Oh, you did last night. That's right. Okay. Anyway, but it, in closing, am I okay? I'm really
going to take questions.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. In closing, I almost lost my train of thought there. It's the partnership is what makes us successful. It's not Century Records, not DP Winch, it's not Valve Oil Valve, it's not Eaton, which is in this town that we run the Murphy Scales programs with and all of that. It's how we work as a team and recognize as a team. And then the other thing is I know that we're better than our competition. And when I take the very tool that's my competitor's tool and I make it better, then I ask that person that supplied me that tool to make it a Miller tool. Because that's what we've done to make you better in this situation so that we're better. But I don't want you to take that very tool and give it to the very person that I compete with that has no understanding as to why we did what we did. And so, you know, you have that form of exclusivity that's done, you know, when we have those, and it doesn't, Whalen Light Bars. You know, Whalen Light Bars have been building light bars for 50, 60 years, privately owned, you know. And we just developed a new light bar 2 years in the making. That's the Miller light bar. That's Miller's and only Miller's. And everybody else is pissed, you know, because, you know, we go out and we market it. We listen to what those guys want on the side of the road. We recognize that they lose more lives. And so we're bringing the incident management light. In our Murphy screen alone, there's 18 different patterns that is now created in this LED light bar that Whalen gives us that are all hopefully the safety tools necessary for that person not to run into the back of that wrecker. And it becomes a very critical part. So the partnership is critical. We've relied since 88 on DP. You've had a lot of competitors that have come in the door, Ramsey being one of them, on just offer us free winches and to do this. You know, we've been affected by offshore, as I mentioned earlier, and the pricing on that. And we remain within the family because it's an established thing that's in there. It's there's two hearts to a wrecker, and that's one of them. And the other one is the hydraulic. You know, you got to have that support to make that winch work and the boom go up and down. So a partnership is very, very critical on that side too. So it's very important, you know, that we maintain that and we keep that and we have that relationship that's ongoing that has been here with us, you know, for these past 2 decades plus. Questions? Come on now. Hold it. Yes, sir. Hold on a second here. He's asking what the recovery cost is for a tractor crib. Darn good question. In those few three slides that I showed you right in there, some of the states and this one individual out of Alabama, lower part of Alabama, Dothan, they came up with a program called Price by the Pound. And so if it's 80,000 pounds, it was 5 cents was a minimum, you know, and this would be the minimum price that would be done with the recovery. And then you threw weekends and hazardous material and releasing and all of those other things that it increased it for the price per the pound. And that was kind of, that's still used today. It's not etched in stone. The tower has to get on Oklahoma, Florida, Ohio, if he's on state patrol or he's doing city or county work, and he submits his class A, B, and C, and maybe R for recovery record at an hourly rate. Okay, and then, an hourly rate for one of those tow trucks right up in there would be around $750 for those big $700,000, and they would run a 3-hour minimum. So, you know, no matter what is the thing, he's looking at $22,000 before he gets out there. Some of those recoveries that you saw in there, I'd probably tell you that that recovery of that load of pork that was in there was probably around $12,000 to $14,000. The time it was all done, you got two rotators, two small wreckers, you got your manpower, you got your skid steer, you know, and truthfully, when it's all said and done, you got time back at the shop that you should do to put that wrecker back in place so the next time it's being used, it's ready to go and you don't go, oh shit, you know, I ran that cable out 200 feet, I used only 25 and I got 175 feet of you know, soft lay cable in there. Yes.
On your military trucks, do you all put armor plating on
them,
or does the military do that?
All right, question is, on the MRAP vehicles that we did with MaxPro, did we do armor plating in them? When we did the MaxPro program, they brought us, MaxPro, Navistar, brought us a non-moving MRAP vehicle that you saw on the very last slide, okay? Had an engine in it. They didn't have the MRAP plate at the bottom on it yet because they didn't have one that fit. They brought it into a lowboy, and it was some of us Tennessee rednecks, and I use that term very, you know. We actually installed the drive line and we drove that vehicle around for 2.5 weeks when we were creating the marketing thing in order to go over by Volkswagen, and Peter will know where we were at exit number. We tore that property up, you know, creating these fields, and I wanted to keep doing some point of thing of protecting the valve body and the PTO, and they said no. That's to me, that's disposable, and that was weight. So at that point, it made sense. What they were looking for were the actual bodies inside and protecting them on that. So that's where the MREC. And I will tell you this, and they have weight issues that we've got to deal with. Being able to get on airplanes, being able to get, you know, hung up from an helicopter, being transported or being on the ships or being lifted. And then in a lot of applications, like in Norway, they have to be as legal and get this as what a normal tractor trailer is. Now, you just can't do that. Just, you know, when I was showing you with the body, as far as, you know, our wreckers, the design of that wrecker goes on the two frame rails, everything that's designed truck-wise, and yet I'm all the way back out here. You know, it's the same thing. I was 2 hours on the phone with a lobbyist, a legislator, and the attorney for the Department of Transportation in the state of Tennessee. And we're going to get rules and regulations that allows the tower to really, for the first time in any state, be able to tow legally. Because I take a truck that's designed from Peterbilt and Kenworth, and when it comes to me, it weighs $8,000 on the drives. I have no, it's just about normal, 8,000 up here and about 10.5 on, you know, the steer axle. Every road tractor you see out there, that's kind of the norm, what's in there. So I got $8,000. My target goal in our 25-51-30, the 25-ton unit, is when I'm installed, I weigh 20,000 pounds. So real quick, let's just do some math. All right, here's my wrecker, and I'm tanned up. So when it comes in there, I'm 10 here, and I'm 8. Now I go and I install a body on that cabin chassis, and I go to about 20,000 pounds. Now remember, we're weighing somewhere in between that 10 to 11K on that steer axle. Now I'm gonna go pick up that road tractor that's broke down, okay? And I'm gonna tow it in. How much does this weigh?
Not
How much does this pay?
Okay, 10 or 11, right? Different than that. Are you listening? I'm different than that. So I'm 20. So what does that make this? 31? Okay. Remember when you guys, I'd asked you about the tensioner and everybody in the room was wrong? You guys are good at being wrong. Okay. When I go and I lift this road tractor, I'm taking my 20,000, I'm doing the 11 to say, so it's 31. Or what happens to the front?
It's
lighter because my lever up in here, and so this becomes, this goes from, with the wrecker on it, now I'm going to just say I'm 14, so it goes down to 9. That 5,000 pounds goes right here. And so I'm now 36,000. And in states, you are legal at 34. So that's the key thing that we did in that 5130 was to meet this. That's the challenges that we've got, you know, and the color, we're one, semi-emergency, number two, we're handcuffed with the fact that we've got to start with the foundation that we have no control over, rear axles, frames, drive line stability, and all that.
Next. It's good. Go.
You mentioned that cable management was a problem quite often.
Yes.
Does Miller recommend an inspection or replacement, or is that up to the customer?
Yeah, that's a good question. The less you can get involved, the better off you are. As simply as that. We
recognize that, you know, cable is a critical part of what we do. We do the recommendation as to that cable capacity. Now, I got my butt chewed out by a Brit 24 years ago when we were up in Canada and we had sold a 9055 on an all-wheel drive Western Star to the, it was to the Canadian military, but it was actually a British operation at the fort up there in, I think it's Rains, Calgary. The guy came in and I ended up, Burton was his name. This guy, for 25, 30 years, lived recovery in the British military. And is Patrick on? Is he in here?
Yeah,
step out for a minute. Good that I can say this. I know why the French and the Germans lost two world wars, okay? The Germans overthink everything and are too damn intelligent, okay? And the French, they're just fucking stubborn. I'm sorry. It happens in Quebec and all that. And the Brits, the British, they just think that everything they do is right and everyone else is stupid. You know, it's really when you start, and I don't want, it's general, okay? I'm generalizing big time. But I deal with the French because we own a French company, Jean-Georges. Now, this is a cool story. John George, he calls, everything you do in the United States is Mickey Mouse. You know, you're going to go pursue, you're going to be sitting on my mind, you know, you don't get a lot of product. So he's got a box. Oh, right now, I get by it. So John George, the president of Jigey, he's got a box in his office. And it's like this, it's got a handle, and it's got a glass door. And in it, in it are two sledgehammers, okay? One's 20 pounds and one's 10. And you're in a manufacturing assembly facility and there is no hammers allowed in anybody's toolbox anywhere on the plant floor. And if you have to have a hammer to do something, he damn well wants to know what the hell you're doing with it. You know, and that's pretty slick because it shows you the pride that's in, you know, in his product up on side, but it just, it's kind of that. So anyway, Burton, he comes up to me, and we've got your, at that time, the DP 45,000 pound winch on there, and we have 3/4 inch cable, and that 3/4 inch cable, the breaking strength, I believe is 19,180 LPS, and we've got a 45K winch. And so he looks at me and he goes, hey, dumb American, you know, how come you have a cable that's only rated at 19,000 and you sold us a 45,000 pound winch? I look at him and I said, because that's what they tell you it is. You know, I didn't make the cable. He says, that's just not right. He says, with Rotzler, you know, which is what they had, you know, they put the rating of that cable, you know, as to what that winching capability is. You know, it really got me to the point that again, that door opens out of the box. I went and I found out, well, how come Rotzler could do this? And it's because they go and they get their own cable made by this person stuck somewhere in the Alps Road mountains that I've yet to find. But it's a galvanized steel or core cable, and it's better than DiePak 8, and it's what we use in our rotators. You know, and it does have the highest capacity of what's up it's in there, but it's expensive. You know, so working with safe load limits in every aspect of every tool that we do, whether it's a Crosby, you know, screw pin shackle or master link, or, you know, the cable or the snatch block that's supplied to us, and in that is very critical, is because it's only as good as what we know it is when it's new. Once that guy goes out and uses it, whether it's correctly or incorrectly, you are losing, you know, losing life expectancy to it. Okay, I like these, keep going. How far do I drive to work every morning? 21 miles.
How long does it take
you? About 27. I get it. When I leave my house, I have three stop signs up on what I call the ridge that I run. And I don't have a stoplight until I pull off the exit at the interstate. We're right on the interstate. In closing, we're good?
Okay.
In closing, you know, again, going back to the people in the company, we did a major facelift on our factory about 10 or 12 years ago. And one of the biggest things it did is it gave a whole new image that was visible from the interstate. But the other thing is that I happen to know the lady who was head of the department. I said, can I come in and cut all of these overgrown trees and shrubberies that are right in front of our plant that were grown up that didn't allow this plant to be seen? She said, you know, we got to do that maintenance. You know, we'll work it for you. And so a couple months later, boom, here came these things and whop, and then you had complete visibility of Miller Industries. So we had the new face, the new logo that we had done, nice blue LED, says Miller out on the front. And it came for the first time a pride for the actually hourly and everybody that worked in there, because now we were a visible factor in the community. You know, and the people, when they would play football or they'd go to the church or what have you and say, where do you work? And you go, Miller. And they go like, oh yeah, that's the place on the interstate. Things are looking good, you know, and whatever. And we have our cab and chassis and we had the military runs and we put our vehicle up on a stand so when they're going by, you can see those rotators. And the truckers talk about it, and the truckers will have local towers that do their business where they're at. And they'll call that tower and says, hey, I went by Miller. I saw this wild Peterbilt, you know, with this new rotator on that. It's a marketing tool that, you know, that just having that visible thing that sense of pride, you know, and you've got to have that. You gotta have that. I was with this gentleman yesterday, been with Crosby for 4 years. 4 years. His dad got him the job when he was still in high school, going in there. And it was just, you could tell that he had that sense of pride of, you know, being with Crosby. And that's what we do. You know, I've got boys that were very few now that actually were with the Holmes Company, you know, prior to coming up the century in 1974 when we built Udawal. I came on board in 77. So, you know, there's that sense of pride of what you do, being in your community, and that you build something. And I can remember in closing Ralph telling me, he said, we hired this engineer, and this engineer actually worked on building hospital beds and potty stands and all this other stuff. And he says, man, you don't ever see that when you're out on the road in the interstate and you see what you built pass you going the opposite way. There's a sense of pride that really grabs you. We had a engineer that works for me, P.E., Mark Dyer. His dad was director of engineering at Auburn. And we would have engineering, they'd come up and do their doctorate or their graduating thing when we would give them a project that helped us because of, you know, diversing a project in there. And the first group that came up, as they were getting ready to leave to get on the bus, I said, I want to tell you right now today, I have screwed your lives up from that day now going forward. And they all looked at me, young kids and everything, and they go like this. I says, there's not going to be a car carrier, a small wrecker, or a large wrecker that you pass now that you won't recognize. I said, I'm done. I'm just telling you, you're now hooked. You're part of the family. And a month later, the phone rings, and we're doing our first, they have four groups. And the last guy that presented his group on what he wanted to do, he says, Mr. Hawkins, just want to let you know you're right. Not damn right I'm right, but what am I right about? And he goes like, we are now screwed because there's no time when I pass in my vehicle, bicycle, or walking that I don't know, recognize every small record car carrying, large record running down the road. So it's addicting. It's addicting. Thank you very much. I appreciate you all taking the time. I appreciate you inviting me to have the time. And hopefully I taught you a little bit about passion for our business and our business. So thank you very much. I really appreciate it.
Thank you, John, very much. We appreciate it. So now every time you go buy a wrecker, right, you're gonna look and say, is it a Miller? And it's gonna be, of course. And the good thing is, if it's a large one, it's gonna have our product on it. So, John, thank you very much. We really appreciate you coming out and spending the time
thank
this morning.
Thank you for everything you guys do, all right?
So that concludes the program for this morning with John. Joe, do you have something? Okay, so we'll give her an award a little later. But we have the sales team. I think we're going to take a short break. Is going to come back in here and continue the program. Everybody else, I'm glad you came in to participate. You know, we wanted to make sure you could see how the product's used. I think it's exciting. You know, really understand where our product ends up, how it's used, and you know, John did a great job showing that. So thanks everybody for participating as well. We appreciate it.